it may be separating by miles per hour out there. In here, they're just a few feet apart. To my left, the Phillips Ford. Jeff Bodine qualified solidly in the field yesterday. They're getting ready for happy hour, which you'll see later today on ESPN2. Now, a few feet away, the empty stall belongs to Jerry Nadeau's Cartoon Network Ford. He is one of seven guys out on the line getting ready to roll the dice and re-qualify. And you want to see a real roll of the dice? Come with me. Now, yesterday in first round qualifying, Morgan Shepherd took the Joe Falk Chevrolet to the 36th fastest time. That means they're the last car in the field right now based on time and speed. They have elected not to run. Why? Well, the sign right here may tell it all. They don't have a sponsor. We'll race for cash. But if one guy makes it in the field today, these guys here go home. Talk about guts of a gambler.
It is a beautiful day at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. The Hoosier sky is painted Carolina blue and dotted by puffy white clouds. It is sunny and very warm. Just a magnificent day here, unless you're one of the seven men that must try to re-qualify to make the Brickyard 400. Right now, it is 80 degrees. Yesterday afternoon, under overcast skies, it was just 63 degrees. Needless to say, the track temperature is much warmer right now. In fact, Derrike Cope was the second fastest man on the track in this morning's practice session. He ran a lap of 51.70. That would put him 39th on the grid. If he does not improve that time, he could be a man without a seat in the Brickyard 400. Yes, it's a bright and sunny day in Indianapolis, but it will be a dreary afternoon for several Winston Cup teams.
Here's what happened in first round qualifying yesterday. Ernie Irvin put himself on the pole for the second straight year. Some great runs from some drivers. Kenny Irwin, Jeff Green, Buckshot Jones qualified in 15th position. The top 25 were locked into position, guaranteed a starting spot in this year's Brickyard 400. And everybody through the 38th position have elected to stand on their time. However, those drivers with yellow marks there on the right have indicated after their practice session that they will try to re-qualify here in the next few minutes. And this is what they're up against, Benny, and it is a major, major hurdle.
It really is. Morgan Shepherd is the 36th fastest qualifier. That's all the cars are going to take all time. His speed in seconds was 51.511. This morning in practice, the best Derrike Cope could do was 51.701. He was the fastest car, the second fastest car in the practice this morning. These guys, he has got to pick up at least a quarter of a second. Hutch Strickland from yesterday's qualifying has to pick up over a half second just to beat Morgan Shepherd. And the temperature today, so much warmer, it's going to be so difficult for these guys to do it. But they have no choice. They must try.
That's right. They have no other alternative. Bill Everett.
With Sammy John's crew chief for Hutch Strickland, who just left on his warm-up lap, can you race your way into the Brickyard 400?
I tell you what, we've got a guy who's really going to give it a try. It's awful hot today, so it's going to be tough.
How was your car this morning?
We were a little bit off. The heat brought a lot more change to the track than we thought. And we adjusted on it, and we'll see what we got here.
Can you just tell the fans how you feel right now as a crew chief?
It's pretty nerve-wracking. I feel bad for Caterpillar and all the guys that worked hard back to shop.
Good luck.
Benny, we spent a major length of time yesterday during our rain show talking about emotions that are involved in auto racing, and especially a race like this. Boy, there are all kinds of emotions down there right now, and including in that cockpit.
Oh, and he just missed that corner a little bit. He comes off turn one, going across the short chute. He needed to keep that car down just a little bit. It could cost him before the run is over.
He ran a 51.981 yesterday in his qualifying run, a 173.140. We're comparing, of course, to the 36th fastest, the 26th, I'm sorry. That was the first position, not guaranteed a position yesterday in first round.
That's Steve Grissom's time, and we see that Hutch Strickland is 0.8 of a second slower. Now he's over a second slower than Steve Grissom's 26th time place time. So, unfortunately, this Caterpillar car will not be in the Brickyard 400.
And he was not in last year's Brickyard 400 either. He did participate in the first three, however, with his best finish being an 18th in 1996. There's the report, 44th fastest.
Man. And there we see, 26 through 36, 52.515 for Hutch Strickland.
major disappointment for the Buzz McCall team here on the racetrack, coming out of corner number two and gathering up some momentum as he comes down the backstretch. Here's the number nine car, driven by Jerry Nadeau. Guy who is on the hot seat. We talked about this car a little bit earlier, Doc.
Talking about rolling the dice, Joe, I guess when looking at that first time for the Caterpillar car, you made a good move.
Well, we won't know until all of them go, but it was a tough decision, but, you know, we had to base on, we don't have that much experience, and I just wanted to make the best management decision I could, and looking at everything, and we were here and tested 3 days. I don't think anybody's going to go any faster.
Maybe today your luck will turn around. You don't have a sponsor. Maybe by rolling the dice and taking the gamble, maybe getting in the Brickyard, someone will say, hey, let's jump on board.
Well, hopefully it will. We've got an excellent team, and we've certainly proved that. And Morgan's been a welcome addition to it and brings with it a lot of experience. And I think we're going to look for some good things the second half of the year with Musk.
All right, Joe, we'll keep our fingers crossed. The crew behind him watching the video screens and watching qualifying in the garage, they can't bear to even walk out the road to see him as they come by.
Well, if practice speeds have anything to do with it, he is going to be in good shape. Here's the checkered flag, and Jerry Nadeau has completed his second-round qualifying run. Right now, it looks like he's going to fall somewhere around 42nd, make that 43rd fastest overall.
The heat today is just going to keep these cars from going fast. Right now, there is a cloud, but it's a very small one. These guys need a cloud that will cover this entire racetrack and stay there throughout their qualifying run.
Probably not enough for Robbie Gordon, who will be our next qualifier.
No, we see the sunshine is on the backstretch. Here where we're our location, it is in the shade. But...
Well, Bill is standing by with Kurt Roehrig, the owner of this car.
And dramatically cooler here on pit road when the sun does go behind a cloud. You were third fastest in the morning practice, but that speed would not get you into this race. Do you have any more left, Kurt?
Robbie's going to give it all he's got. We had a number of changes. We didn't have our best setup on with our best tires during the session, so there's a hope. It's slim. We just kind of got behind with the rain on Wednesday practice-wise. Robbie's going to give it everything he got.
Certainly knows his way around this track. We'll see how he does. Bob?
Missed turn one, did not get down to the white line. You got to get that car down the white line and make that turn as straight as possible. That's pretty good corner there in turn two, but he's lost some time in one.
He knows the racetrack. He competed in Indianapolis 500s, and he started 11th and finished 28th here last year. But Robbie Gordon faces a major battle here.
We can see all these cars, 42nd, 44th. That's where they're going to shake out. Oh, there he gets a little bit loose in turn three.
Like he almost slid through the corner, coming off of it at least.
And there is almost a second slower than the 26th time with Steve Grissom. So Robbie Gordon will not qualify the Yellow Freight Ford Taurus in the Brickyard 400.
45th fastest at a 52.719, 170.716. So far, none of the second day qualifiers have been able to work themselves into the field. Second round qualifying continues in a moment. Derrike Cope is on the racetrack, second round qualifying. He banged the wall pretty good coming out of four yesterday.
So far, he's in there. 34th best so far. Oh, but he's a little bit high in that corner.
Oh,
he's the wall again.
Did it again.
Did it again in turn three.
Wow. Coming into the short chute. He banged the wall just like yesterday. He's still in it, though. He's going to be real close. He's down to 36th position now, down to 40th.
But you see, he lost all of his momentum up in turn three. I'm afraid that little brush with the wall is going to cost him a chance.
Oh.
43rd best. He had it going, but he had to keep his foot in.
Sure,
he
no
had
choice.
He saw the wall coming. He's not an idiot. He sees the wall coming. He said, but what can I do? If I back off, I won't make it. I might miss the wall.
Mm.
Unfortunately, he didn't.
Wow. Here it is again. Entering turn number three. Okay, coming off the corner.
And we can see that he got in the corner too hard. He had no choice. He had no choice. The rules dictate that you got to go as hard as possible. This is what happened yesterday, coming off turn four. What you just saw is going in three. This is turn four yesterday. Bam. I think this car is probably thinking Derrike doesn't like it very much.
What an effort he gave, but it's all for naught.
He did. He really, folks, that was as hard as you could go right there. If it had moved that wall out about 3 feet, he might have made it.
Well, Jerry is with Hunt Strickland, who isn't a happy man.
Bob, that puts it mild. To the Caterpillar team, the frowns, the long faces. Hutch, you had no choice. You had to go back out. You were 46 passes yesterday, and it was so warm today.
Yeah, we really did, Jerry. You know, it just, I tell you, it is disappointing for us. You know, everybody on this Cat team has really worked awful hard this week. You know, we just, you know, it's like a nighttime qualifying at Charlotte. If you don't do it at night, you know, it's just not going to happen during the day for the next day. But, you know, I tell you, my hat's off to all these guys, everybody at Cat and Siemens and Deluxe Paints and everybody. You know, they just, you know, just an unfortunate thing for us.
Hutch Strickland, his day is over and probably his weekend. Another tough break for the driver of the 78. You see the damage on that car, number 78, Gary Bradberry. Boy, just it just gets, goes from bad to worse here in second round qualifying.
He hit it hard coming out of one, didn't he?
He did, but again, they have no choice but go out and try to do something that's impossible to do almost. Watch Bradberry. He goes in the corner. He realizes he can't get through the corner that fast, but he has to try. And there he gets it loose. He tries to save it, but the second time he cannot save it and goes up and backs in the fence. And you're right, hard contact.
From another angle.
And he says, man, this thing's going to hit hard. But there again, what choice do they have, Bob? If they go down and just run around the racetrack, they're not going to make the race.
Right.
And this is the Brickyard 400. This is not a
just
preliminary
race.
Just another race. It's not a preliminary race. This is the big one.
Well, the window net is down, so we would assume that Gary is okay. He did take a hard shot, though, coming out of corner number one in the short chute. So Gary Bradberry's dream has also ended here at Indianapolis, and the 30 car also hitting the wall here in qualifying. ESPN Speed World coverage of second round qualifying for the Brickyard 400 being brought to you by ESPN Video. Get your officially licensed NASCAR videos from ESPN Video. More coverage coming up later today. We'll have happy hour at 6 o'clock Eastern, RPM tonight with John Kernan at 7, and Benny and I have a program before they go green as we set the stage for tomorrow's big day. It all begins at 11:30 with RPM today, a one-hour pre-race show at noon on ESPN, then the Brickyard 400 at 1 o'clock over on ABC Sports, and RPM tonight will wrap it all up at 7 o'clock tomorrow evening. Well, a big crowd has turned out here, not only for second round qualifying, but for the International Race of Champions, which will be held here this afternoon and shown on ABC after tomorrow's Brickyard 400. They're loading the car onto the rollback.
And we haven't seen Gary Bradberry get out of the car. We don't know that he hasn't, but there we see him going down in turn one, just as hard as he could go. Then it's got to stick, and I'm not going to make it. It didn't stick. The result from that is, bam. In the inside wall, outside wall.
Derrike Cope had a problem in turn coming out of turn three.
Another situation. If he backed off the gas, he's not going to qualify. He didn't back off the gas. The wall caught him.
Jerry Punch is with Chuck Ryder.
Well, the right side of the gumout Pontiac, second car on the second day. This is the backup car that pulled out late yesterday after the first car in first round qualifying touched the wall in turn four. And, Chuck, your driver, Derrike Cope, gave it all he had, got out. He's headed back to the truck, very disappointed. But what a tough one for the crew.
It was tough. Derrike did. He did a great job in the gumout, Jimmy Dean Pontiac. And it's just a shame what's happened. We've put both cars flatting the right side of the cars, both in the qualifying laps. And it's kind of difficult when you work all year to build a great team and come to Indy and have something like this to happen.
He paused for a moment when he got out of the car to talk to you prior to hanging his head and heading back to the garage area. What did he tell you happened out there?
Well, he said he just tried. He said, I'm sorry it happened. He said he tried, and he did. We thought we had a great lap there. I mean, to run a 52 flat under these conditions and still hit the wall, that would have been a lap that would have got us into the race.
That is Chuck Ryder. And Benny, if you could have seen Derrike Cope when he climbed out of the car, you would know how much it meant to be a part of the Brickyard 400. Very emotional, very upset. He gave it his all. It just wasn't quite enough.
And you can understand him rather going back to the motor home and not spending any time with us, because it is such a major disappointment.
I mean, certainly he does not want to look in the TV camera and smile and say, well, we gave it our all and whatever, because he's crushed. He's devastated. He is not going to be here tomorrow. Derrike Cope considers himself and may be one of the best stock car drivers in the country. He's not going to be here tomorrow to show the world that he can do that. I mean, how devastating is that?
Yeah, there's just no words that you can use to explain that, just as there were no words yesterday for Kenny Irwin Jr. to explain his elation when he made the field in his hometown. So there is a gamut of emotion here at Indianapolis. Two more qualifiers to go. The cleanup continues at the Gary Bradberry crash. Back with those two qualification attempts in a moment.
Hey, I mean, it's time to go home, go in the bell tower. You know, those guys a few years ago could not face the public when something happened. They go hide in the bell tower. Yep. It would be time to go hide in the bell tower.
Well, one guy who dodged a bullet here this afternoon is with Bill Weber.
A couple of guys, Morgan Shepherd and Joe Falk, welcome to the 1998 Brickyard 400. How does that sound?
Man, I tell you, you know, I missed this thing last year. We've been in every one until the one last year. And then yesterday, we didn't get a chance to block off, and the rain came, and when we did, it was so loose, but it was just loose enough that that we did get in. I mean, this is almost heart failure. I mean, you know, here's a team that badly need of a sponsor, nothing on the quarter panels, and almost didn't make this race. I'm just tickled to be a part of this with Joe Falk and these guys.
This ownership thing, Joe, that's a piece of cake. Never a sleepless night, nothing to it.
There's nothing to it, no. It's pretty easy, but I had hair when I started.
That was this morning you had some, didn't you?
That was this morning. I've lost a few today, I can tell you that.
How's that feel, man?
It feels great to make it. We made this race last year, and we had a lot of confidence, and just the weather just played in a havoc with us yesterday, and being a small team, we all didn't react like we should have and thought about the process of what was going to happen last night. And it was great. Morgan did a great job getting the car home last night with what he did.
Well, you gambled. It's not the Powerball, but it's probably a little bit better. Congratulations, guys.
Thank you. Well, last time I started back here, I ran fifth, so we can get there.
We'll hold you to that.
Thank you.
Morgan Shepherd will be in tomorrow's race.
There is disappointment at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway among these guys because they have tried and failed to make the field. But there's jubilation, on the other hand, for many other drivers who are in tomorrow's fifth annual Brickyard 400 at Indianapolis. Back at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, we've been here for the past 3 days bringing you all the preliminary practice and qualifying for the Brickyard 400. And now we know the 43 drivers who will all be seeking this trophy and their name at the bottom of it. It, of course, is on permanent display over at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway Hall of Fame Museum.
Huge crowd here today in anticipation of the IROC race.
Let's check the grid for tomorrow's running of the race. It's Irvin and Jared on the front row. Jeff Gordon, who won here, of course, in 1994, will have a former state mate, if you will, Kenny Irwin, right beside him in the fourth position. John Andretti makes the field in ninth, and Rusty Wallace will start from the 14th position.
And Buckshot Jones back in 15th. But the big problem for the other competitors, Mark Martin, is starting seventh. That's his favorite place to start. As a matter of fact, told us that's where he wanted to start. As you take a look at 16 through 30, Mike Skinner leads that group. Steve Park will start in 25th spot. Steve Grissom will be the car today that will start 26th, stood on his time. Ricky Rudd, last year's winner, and Earnhardt back there.
And now the remainder of the field, 31 through 43, and of course you see the drivers that have gotten in on provisionals, including Elliott, Musgrave, Benson, Brett Bodine, Jerry Nadeau, and Rick Mast, and Darrell Waltrip with the previous champion's provisional. Here's Jerry Punch.
Well, Gary Bradberry makes a long walk back from the Clarion Medical Center here at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Gary, what happened out there?
Well, we've really been fighting a push since we got here and made a lot of changes on the car, but hadn't helped any. We made more changes before qualifying, and the car pushed really bad on the get-go lap as far as up off the corner, but the changes we'd made just loosened us up too much getting in and just got loose getting in one. And track's so flat, if the car slips much, it's hard to catch it.
You told me 2 weeks ago you lost your primary engine builder, Larry Wallace, when Roger Penske bought that group, and you've been trying to fight from a down horsepower position, trying to make it up yourself, and it's just that almost impossible for the driver to do it.
Well, yeah, you know, we had some decent motors this weekend and everything, but we just got out there and never really got a handle on it. And, you know, when you go qualify, you run the car a little extra hard, and we loosened the car up. It ended up being looser than what I expected getting in, and, you know, just it's hard to make it up.
Well, come back hard in 2 weeks. We'll see you at Michigan.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Gary Bradberry. Let's go to Bill Weber.
Well, there's plenty of disappointment back here. The 19 Yellow Freight car not on the field. Kurt Rorick, the car owner, just a big handshake for Robbie Gordon. And I know you're disappointed. This is one of your favorite places.
You know, we did everything we knew how to get the car quick, and we just missed it. You know, I think we did make the car quicker today. We were third in practice, and had a pretty good, you know, had a lot of hope going into qualifying, but with the sun coming out, it's just slippery. No, everybody that went out went slower. I believe the track's, you know, at least a half a second slower. We ran the same time we ran yesterday this morning. So, you know, it's unfortunate.
Kurt, your regular driver, Tony Range, had a magnificent run in the Craftsman Truck Race last night at Raceway Park. An amazing top five finish coming back from two laps down. I know you were hoping some of that magic might rub off here today.
Well, you know, sometimes that's what's fun about having a two-car operation. The Yellow Freight Ford F-150 was, the truck was okay. Tony was awesome last night. He did a great job. And this is a real disappointment, but we're in here kind of on a limited schedule, and we're learning a lot. And we're learning some of the elements that we're missing, wind tunnel time, et cetera, to run with the big boys. And we'll be back.
Best of luck to you, and Robbie, good seeing you again. See you down the road.
Thanks, Bill.
So Robbie Gordon among those who did not make the field for this year's race. Well, the qualifying is over, and now the focus changes to getting these cars set for happy hour, which will be coming up later today and which we will have for you on ESPN2. Back with more from Indianapolis in a moment. It takes three networks to do it, but we have covered and will cover everything for you regarding this year's Brickyard 400 on ESPN2 tonight, 6 o'clock, happy hour, also on the deuce, RPM tonight. The big network ESPN at 7:30 tonight as Benny and I set the stage for tomorrow's race. Then tomorrow, it begins with RPM today on the deuce, on the grid, 1 hour pre-race show at noon. Don't forget that the Brickyard 400, the actual running of the race, will be at 1 o'clock Eastern Time on ABC. And then RPM tonight will wrap everything up at 7 o'clock tomorrow night on the deuce. Bill Weber is down in the pole sitter's garage.
And this is the pole sitting Skittles Pontiac that Ernie Irvin will lead the field to the green flag with here Saturday afternoon in the fifth running of the Brickyard 400. And I'm thrilled for Ernie, but I'm just as happy for his crew chief, Ryan Pemberton, who's working on the car. Just take us through what you're doing right now, getting ready for happy hour.
We're putting in a fresh motor for the race, hooking up some brake blowers. He drives awfully hard here. Got to slow him down every now and then. And, you know, just going through our pre-race checklist.
You're a pretty young guy. How you feel right now? You got the pole sitting car at the Brickyard.
It's been great so far this weekend. The whole week has been pretty good. Tested good, unloaded, run fast, pop out on the pole. Pretty exciting.
You struggled a little bit last year with Derrike in the car. You put Ernie in. You've got five top tens coming into here, so obviously it takes a while to get a new team up to speed, but you guys look like maybe now you've hit your stride.
Yeah, you know, second time around at most of these racetracks, we're going to be a lot better. We're going to unload better, have a better idea of what we want, what we're looking for. So we're looking forward to the second half of the season.
For the fans that don't know, your older brother, Robin, is crew chief for Rusty Wallace. Has he been by to congratulate you?
First one by. I appreciate everything he's done for me in the past, and we're excited.
And he did come down and talk to you just before Ernie went out on the track, because Rusty had been in an IROC car out trying to drive the track to look at it. Did he give you any words of advice or any instructions at that point?
He let us know the track was okay, and I think he was just kind of gauging off us for himself. So, you know, Rusty went out. I think Dale Jarrett went out, checked the track out, make sure it was right. So those drivers, they watch out for each other.
Okay, get back to work. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's Ryan Pemberton, and all the Skittles crew deserve, they deserve a big box of Skittles. They're on the pole for the Brickyard 400. I think they got a little money for that too, Bob.
How has the pole sitter, however, done in previous Brickyard 400s? Well, not that well, really. Jeff Gordon started from the pole in 95 and finished sixth, and that's been the best performance. Mass, the inaugural pole sitter, finished 22nd. Then Jeff the next year, 37th, and Ernie Irvin started from the pole last year and finished in 10th position. So the pole has not necessarily been the place to start from.
I think that's just the luck of the draw. I don't think, obviously, Ernie Irvin has a great race car, and I think that he will be a force to be reckoned with. Jeff Gordon starting back in third spot. Once again, that's where he said he wanted to start, was third, because mm-hmm. that's where he won from before.
Down to Jerry Punch.
Well, back in the hospitality area, we got Kenny Irwin getting some advice from another Texaco star. How about this guy, Mario Andretti, 1969 winner of the Indianapolis 500. And first of all, Mario, good to see you back here at the Brickyard.
Thank you, Doc. Nice to be here.
Now, what kind of advice are you giving the kid here about the aura that is Indianapolis Motor Speedway?
Well, I'm not giving him much advice at all. I'm just telling him to stay slim and be able and eat nice light breakfast. And be relaxed, because I think he has a really good car and a good operation, and I know he's he really found a way around here, it looks like, this time. So I'm out there cheering for him, just like I usually cheer for Michael.
Well, how about you, young man? The butterfly is now gone from qualifying, the emotion of getting in the field. Now you're focused a little bit on the task tomorrow.
Yeah, you know, we had a good practice session this morning, so I just come over here to talk to Mario. Actually, we had breakfast this morning, and he did have a lot of good advice. So, just
not just dietary hints, things about the racetrack.
No, actually, I mean just about racing in general. So, you know, if I can just take some of that, I know we'll be a lot better off.
Mario, the first time someone comes to race at this racetrack, it is somewhat overwhelming when you go out there and walk out of Gasoline Alley and see just the harangue of the Hoosier hysteria, all the people screaming and yelling.
Well, yes, the Indianapolis mystique is very, very present here, no question. And you can see that the Brickyard has come into its own very quickly. It's a real incredible event, incredible showcase here. And it looks like all these guys, you know, they haven't had a chance to be in open wheel cars. Here they have the chance to do it with their own toys and enjoy what this place has been able to give the rest, you know, the auto racing world all these years. And so it's a wonderful place to be. It looks like a lot of happy faces around here, actually.
Mario, you made the transition from the open wheel cars, Formula One, and open wheels to stock cars, and of course won the Daytona 500. How difficult was it for you to get in a stock car the first time?
Well, it was a lot easier than it would be today. I don't think it was as sophisticated and as competitive in those days. So the trick was to be able to get the proper ride, a good ride. I was contracted for Ford, so I could get one of the top rides, you know, with them. And then just flow with it. You know, today, as I say, it's so much more specialized that I would need one which would do a lot more running and racing and a lot more preparation for it to hope to be competitive. So times have changed, no question. Like I said, we used to do things that we used to move around a lot easier than they would be today.
Speaking of times changing, compare your win in the Daytona 500 with what it would be like maybe to win the Brickyard here. I mean, they're got to be pretty close.
Well, yeah, these are two, when you look at the career, when you look at the goals, I mean, and you want to be ambitious, one of the goals are going to be Daytona for sure, the Brickyard. Daytona has a stronger tradition because you mentioned Daytona, you know, immediately you say Winston Cup, you know, stock cars. So that will always remain the shining star, in my opinion, of stock car racing. But, again, because of the tradition also of motor racing period of Indianapolis, here you have, you know, you'll be battling both. So in a perfect world, I think Kenny wants to win both, and I don't blame him. And if he wins this weekend, he make Texas, I mean, someone that has been to Texaco and got one of these tickets, a millionaire. You know, on this particular...
Yeah, the race to the millions, yeah, indeed.
So, you know, the onus is on you, buddy, you know.
Hey, you got a lot of people in your corner pulling for you here. I mean, it's got to be special. You know, you got a car. Jeff Gordon said, as a native Hoosier, when he came here the first time, he saw success the next morning. Have you seen success for yourself tomorrow?
You know, I sure hope so. I don't know if I'm that confident in saying that, but obviously we do have a great team, Texaco. Robert Yates with the 28 and 88 has had a lot of success here, so hopefully we can carry that tradition on tomorrow.
Good luck to you.
Thanks.
Two of Texaco's most shining stars, the legendary Mario Andretti and the young man who will probably be a legend in our lifetime, Kenny Irwin. Bob?
Starts fourth in tomorrow's Brickyard 400. So where have the Brickyard winners come from in terms of starting positions? Jeff Gordon third in 94, Earnhardt from 13th, Jarrett way back in 24th drove the victory in 96, and Rudd's win last year was from the seventh position. Well, here's a guy that knows all about the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. He's turned more laps here than just about anybody else. We'll be back at Indy in a moment. Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Small crowd on hand today, probably, what, 100, 125,000?
Undoubtedly the biggest crowd that we'll ever see have seen an IROC race.
Yep.
Which they'll see here in just a few minutes.
And, of course, everybody also anxious for happy hour, which comes up a little bit later this afternoon and which we will have for you at 6 o'clock tonight.
By the way, that IROC race will be seen Saturday afternoon, tomorrow afternoon, mm-hmm. after the Brickyard 400. So.
That is correct. First time that the IROC cars have ever run here. Bill Weber standing by with another legend.
Well, certainly one of the most famous faces at the Brickyard, and we saw that number 14 back in victory lane just a few days ago. Congratulations on the win at Charlotte.
Well, thank you. It was a great win for Kenny Brack and Power Team. You know, did such a super job, and like I said, we tried to lose the race, but I guess we're just running fast enough. We made up for all the mistakes we made.
I know you were here when we first brought the NASCAR Winston Cup cars here to the Brickyard. What do you think of them being here, AJ?
Well, I think it's great to have them here. I think, you know, NASCAR needed to be here way before they came here, and I was always for that. I guess I was one of the only Indy guys that was for that, but I was for it 100%, and probably a lot of people badmouth me for being for it, but, you know, I've raced many years. A lot of the NASCAR guys got a lot of friends, and they're super friends of mine. That's reading them here today.
Take us back down memory lane, AJ, some of those years racing the stock cars at Daytona and throughout your career.
Well, actually, I was fortunate enough to, you know, win the 24-hour race down there in the 400 a couple times, the 500, and, you know, finish before up in the 500. It's just many great, great years, you know, and race Atlanta and California and won the road race out there in Ontario. So I go back many years with a bunch of the people, and like I said, a lot of these guys are great friends of mine, and I could probably ask them for anything, they'd do it, and I'd do the same for them.
I know you follow the sport very, very closely. Obviously, Ernie's on the pole here. Gordon has a good starting spot. Mark's lucky number seven. I know you don't want to handicap the field for us, but there's a lot of talent here, isn't there?
There's a bunch of great talent here and a bunch of young, good race drivers. And like I say, I think it would be a toss-up between actually Ernie. He has a luck run against. He hadn't had luck. He's a good friend of mine. But Jeff would be hard to beat. Mark Martin's going to be very hard to beat. He's on a roll, and he's a good race driver. I've known him for a long time. So it's going to be between the top three or four that's up there.
Got that little IROC race thing going on here this afternoon. Are you here as a car owner or as a spectator?
We just finished doing some testing with our cars in Atlanta, and I just flew over here just to spectate.
It's always a pleasure to see you.
Well, thank you.
And congratulations again on Charlotte.
Thank you very much.
That's AJ Foyt, certainly one of the most popular men you can ever find at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
Foyt, by the way, started here in the first Brickyard 400 in 40th position, and he finished in 30th spot. Four-time winner, however, of the Indianapolis 500. A lot of hard work going on back in the garage area as the teams get set for happy hour. We'll take another break and be back with more in just a moment from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. And Speed World has Bryn here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway for Brickyard 400 preparation since Wednesday. We got a lot more coverage for you coming up before the big day. Happy hour, 6 o'clock tonight on the Deuce. RPM tonight at 7 on the Deuce, and at 7:30 over on ESPN, it is the Before They Go Green preview of tomorrow's event. RPM today starts things off tomorrow at 11:30 on the Deuce on the grid. At noon, the Brickyard 400's on ABC at 1 o'clock, and RPM tonight is at 7 with a wrap-up of everything that's happening in the world of motorsports. Well, you know, they used to leave these black marks on the walls for days at a time, but now, boy, they get out there and clean them up immediately, don't they?
I would guess that's Derrick Cope, where he's rushed the wall up in turn three, that they're already whitewashing off the racetrack.
Hmm. Okay, let's go down to Jerry Punch.
Preparations ongoing down in the Penske Kranifus garage. They are putting in a brand new Larry Wallace race engine for happy hour. This will be the motor that will carry Rusty Wallace from 14th starting spot on the grid. possibly to victory lane tomorrow in the fifth annual Brickyard 400. The work underneath the car, making sure everything is nice and slick and smooth. All the cables, all the lines are attached. Now we move around to the side. We're going to show you, take a look at how hard they've worked on this table beside us. On this table, I'm going to move this box. You can count them if you want to. There are about 41 different shock absorbers. And I am told by the crew members that every one of these has been on the race car either in the past couple of days or in testing last week. And crew chief Robin Pemberton sitting in the car. Robin, I'm told you used even more than that.
It's very possible. The thing that we've got going for ourselves, Tom Hoke is our shock guy, and he prepares all the shocks for Jeremy and our car. So we've been through a lot of different changes and iterations with the setup with the shock absorbers.
People in the garage said you guys were killer quick in testing it. You're going to really be the sleeper here tomorrow, that Rusty may be really the guy to beat.
Well, we've come a long way in a year, Jerry. I mean, we've worked real hard on the cars, and the new teammates probably helped us quite a bit. And the guys have worked hard on the car. We didn't qualify as well as we thought we should have, and we made a little change there before qualifying, but we're getting the car better to his liking. I think we're going to be a real good car in the race. We hope we are.
Robin Pemberton talking about coming a long way in a year. They started 43rd last year, a past champions provisional. They start 14th tomorrow. If he pulls it off, it'll be Roger Penske's 12th win at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Talk about winning. The guy won it last year. I think this team around Bill Weber.
And I'm with his crew chief, Bill Engel, and Ricky started 7th a year ago and won here. Mark starts lucky number 7 here, but you guys have to come from 27th. How's your car?
Yeah, car right now is pretty good. We were good in Wednesday's practice. We stayed in the top 10 times all day long, and I think ended up 7th overall going into qualifying yesterday, and something happened. You know, I don't know what one of those gremlins that this team has seemed to had all year long, but we got put it in race trim this morning, went out and ran three different types of setups to choose for what to do for this last practice. We're going back to one of the setups that we had in earlier, and the car ran pretty well. I think if you took out the guys that were trying to re-qualify their times, we'd ended up about 9th quickest this morning. So we're back in the top 10 in speeds. Ricky feels pretty comfortable with the car. We're going to make a couple of changes this afternoon to decide on what to do for tomorrow. I feel pretty good about it right now.
Okay, you don't have to give us all your secrets, but it's just you and me and the camera back here. So just tell us what you're doing to this car. Come on.
Well, we're going to put a pair of 2500s in the front, a pair of 200s in the rear, 7/8 bar in the front, inch bar in the rear, and see how it goes.
I don't believe you. I don't think he's telling the truth. I got one more question for you. Who's your water man this week, your water bottle guy?
Well, what are you doing?
I'm doing the race.
Hey, the job's open.
Yeah. You fired the guy that did it last week, didn't you?
Well, he was so bad, you know.
Who was that?
I think it was Bill Weber,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Okay, get back and work on your car.
Thank you.
Okay, so they have to come from 27th, but as you heard, their car was pretty good here this morning, and this pretty much should resemble race conditions that we're going to see. Of course, Happy Hour will tell the big tale later this afternoon. Back to Cherry in the 24 garage.
All right, standing by with John Hendrick, president of Hendrick Motorsports. By the way, hello to Rick Hendrick back home. Rick, we miss you. We wish you back here very, very soon. John, what a year for brother to take off. No pressure at all.
No pressure at all. Tell you that we talked the other day about that. He said maybe it's a good year, but he'll be back with us next year, and we certainly look forward to that. We certainly miss him, but getting into this like we have this year, it's been certainly interesting to say the least, and it's been a lot of fun in most of the aspects of this, but it's been some tough days too.
You're the guy who should know. I mean, Ray Evernham and the guys back here playing it close to the vest as far as what they're doing with the car, but I think there's a tremendous amount of confidence here. Jeff starting exactly where he started back in 1994 from third spot. This team says this could be our second Brickyard.
This could be the second one. We'll focus when we came here to focus on the Brickyard to win this race, get ourselves in position in the Noble Million. And that's what it's all about, the competition. Jeff thrives on that, to be competitive, to win this race. We know this is one of the most prestigious races of the year for us. But this is like a hometown deal for Jeff, and it's very important to it. This team is focused. They're working hard together, and they're really focused on winning that race tomorrow.
Not to forget your other two owners, Terry Labonte and Ricky Craven, both in the field. 3 of 43 belong to Hendrick Motorsports. Both those guys did a nice job in qualifying.
Terry, talked to Terry this morning. Terry ran the fastest lap he ran since he's been here yesterday in qualifying. Ricky had been in the top as quick as the top three. He's 6, so 3, 6, and 8. We're real pleased with that. Had a truck win last night. A little controversy there, but, you know, that goes along with the racing end of it, but we're real pleased with that. Jack started third last night and won, so we're thinking about that today. Starting third here, maybe another win.
Numbers are there. Good luck to you, John.
Thanks a lot.
John Hendrick, president of Hendrick Motorsports, watching as they work on Jeff Gordon's car number 24, which starts third tomorrow.
Bob? Second round qualifying ended earlier, and the jubilation continues as the 91 team is hanging a new sign over their garage area. They are in tomorrow's Brickyard 400. Back with more right after this. ESPN Speed World coverage of second round qualifying at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway being brought to you by 1010321. New number, same great savings. We take a look at the lucky ones, those who have come here and have made the field for this year's Brickyard 400.
Well, that's job one. Job two is the race, and their job isn't over today. There's one more hour, a happy hour. It will be intense because what the decisions they make in that hour will determine who wins the Brickyard 400.
Jerry Punch.
Mark Martin is the man on a mission, and he will drive the most talented tourist they have in the Roush stable. Yeah, this morning he popped the wall and scratched it up a little bit, but that won't slow Martin down. He will be the man that will start from 7th spot tomorrow in the same car that has carried him to victory lane four times already in 1998. Bill?
We shared the elation of Morgan Shepherd and Joe Falk. They made the Brickyard 400, and happy hour comes later this afternoon. But for a lot of teams, this was the unhappy hour, the hour they will always remember that they did not make the Brickyard 400, sending friends and hardworking crews home a day early.
Happy hour, RPM tonight before they go green, all between now and 8:30 Eastern. Then the Kroger 200 Busch Series Grand National race at 8:30. On ESPN tonight, tomorrow, RPM today on the grid. The Brickyard 400s on ABC, and RPM tonight is at 7 o'clock. Coming up next, Pro Beach Hockey. Thanks for joining us. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.